introductory talks to the topic of optimal transportation in that it relates to nonlinear elliptic PDEs. So this is just one aspect of that whole theory, and that is the aspect that I'll concentrate on. Got sort of delayed coming back from Australia on the weekend, and I only got back last night. So I'll keep moving because in case there's a risk I might fall asleep during my own talk. But this happened to me once at a meeting, and I gave a talk, and you know, when you hear people clap, you know it's the end of a talk. And suddenly I heard people clapping, so I started clapping. Then I realised it was my own talk. So I hope it's not as bad as that. Okay, so the fundamental problem is this Monge-Kantorovich problem. I'm only going to be concerned here with the Euclidean space case, so there are a lot of the interesting work, recent work concerns Riemannian manifolds. So the basic problem is the following. We're given measures mu and nu, and they satisfy a mass balance condition. This means that mu Rn is the same as nu Rn. And then we consider a family of, in the Russian literature, these were called measure-preserving transformations. Since we're talking about mass balance, let me just call them mass-preserving transformations. So these will be mappings from Rn to Rn, which are at least Borel measurable. And the mass they preserve is the mass with that is the they preserve mass in the sense that density mu is transported to density nu. So the condition would then be that mu of T inverse of any Borel set E is the same as nu of E. Borel E in Rn. So in the case that mu and nu have densities 1, then this is just preservation of measure, Lebesgue measure. And another way of writing this, the more common way now, is that you say T mu equals nu, or T pushes forward mu to nu. That's important because when I want to come to the Alexandrov theory, that's about pullbacks rather than push forwards. And this is equivalent to saying that the change of variables formula applies, that the integral of H composed with T, the mu is the same as the integral of H, the nu, and this is for all test functions H in C0, 0, Rn. I guess I want these finite too. Okay, so we're given two measures. We have a notion of measure preserving or mass preserving transformation. Let me use script T to mu nu. And this is the set of mass preserving mappings. And the other, the real essential ingredient is a cost function. And this is going to be a mapping C from Rn cross Rn to R. And okay, you can assume different levels of smoothness of C. I mean, one approach I would support is you make C as smooth as you want and worry about how smooth it need to be later on. There's an approach in the French literature, in particular, say Valani's book, where you make C, you put the minimum amount of smoothness on C at the start. So let me just at least require, and this is not the minimal, but it's a good enough starting place, that C is continuous and they intersect L infinity on the support of mu cross the support of nu. And C represents the cost of moving unit mass from X to Y. I should say optimal, this idea of moving and transportation is a very narrow way of looking at this topic. That's how it started, but many situations can be represented as optimal transportation problems. One example his book may touch on is reflection of light, and they're not really moving points, although you are changing angles in that case. Okay, so from the cost function, we have our cost functional. Ct, and this will be the integral of over c dot t integrated against d mu. And this Monge-Kantorovich problem then is simply to minimize c over t. So it's simply a problem of what we say, finding the measure preserving mapping which minimizes this cost. But I could just as well write it as a maximizing problem. So we could say maximize as well. And I could pass from the minimum problem to the maximum problem simply by replacing C by minus C. I say this because at some point I wanted to come to a normalization where we look at the maximizing problem rather than the minimizing problem. They're equivalent. So we can pass from max to min, min to max, rather simply by C, replacing C by its negative. Yeah? No. This is. No. That's you're thinking of the relaxed problem. This is just a single integral of R. So this is a cx, t of x integrated against d mu x over Rn. So let me just note the two important historical examples. Just call these our primary examples. And the original cost was the Cx given by Cxy equal distance between x and y. And this is the what we'll call the Monge cost. And that's where the subject started. This was introduced by Monge in 1981, famous paper. And Monge's problem was to, 1781, mixed up. You know, sort of gone through a time change, and so, you know, all centuries are the same, like all time is only modulo 12 hours and so on. So, 1781, yeah. Well, this is always mentioned at the start of talks, optimal transportation. The Monge problem is to move a soil from a hole to a heap, or a heap to a hole, with the least amount of work. And the work is proportional to the distance moved. So that's how this cost function comes about. And then there's this is the Monge cost, and then there's this is the most popular one, it's the half of x minus y squared, and we'll just refer to this as the quadratic cost. So this one's relatively simple, this one is bad. I can see it's bad already because it's not a smooth function. Let me just look a little at that quadratic cost and write it in a different form. It's better for the theory. If I just expand that as, if I write Cxy equal to 1/2 x squared plus y squared minus x dot y, then you can see we can write Ct. Look at this, Ct is going to be 1/2, and now I've got an integral of x squared d mu plus a tx squared d mu, and then a minus x dot tx d mu. So, and of course this is just now by our measure preserving conditional mass balance, this is just the integral of x squared d mu plus y squared d nu, and then minus the same integral x dot tx d mu. So minimizing c is equivalent to maximizing c prime of t, where c prime xy is x dot y. So the quadratic cost minimizing problem for this quadratic cost is equivalent to a maximizing problem for just x dot y. So I'll typically refer in the future to as the quadratic cost being this x dot y. So the theory that we want to consider will be extensions of this special case, and it's x dot y rather than this half x squared minus y squared. So it's easy to think of this as this is the example, maximizing the integral of x dot t of x. Okay, well, having arbitrary measures is too general a problem. Some bad situations, these measure-preserving transformations won't even exist. So we're going to assume, particularly since we want to talk about regularity, that the measures always have densities. So we're going to assume mu equals f dx, nu equals g dy. And I want f and g to be supported on bounded domains in, so simplify as well, bounded domains in Rn, so f and g compact support, and in particular we'll suppose the support of f is contained in omega bar and the support of g is contained in some omega star bar, and omega star are bounded domains in Rn. Okay, so that'll be our problem now. Every measures are replaced by functions. You can ask various questions. First of all, what about the existence of optimal mappings? You can ask about the uniqueness. And we can ask about their smoothness. And the question I wanted to focus on in these lectures, I won't get very far today as far as this question goes, is when are there smooth diffeomorphism? Solutions. With this FK problem. So what are the conditions to have smooth solutions, and then I would get diffeomorphisms by applying those conditions with the variables exchanged. So what are the conditions to have smooth diffeomorphism solutions? And what sort of conditions would these be? These would be have to be conditions on the cost function, first of all. For what costs are there good solutions? But it also would be a condition on the domains. And for what domains, omega, are there smooth solutions? So we've got two quantities there, the costs and domains, for which we need conditions. Okay, so let me start by, I can just
why, why is the domain an issue? I mean, all you're saying is they're supported in the domain.
Well, okay, sure, okay. They're supported in the domain, fine. Yeah. Now, if I'm going to get any nice behavior, I would want my densities to be positive in the domain to start with. So those domains would be precisely the supports. Okay, so let me, I want to start by just displaying very quickly the PDE that's involved. And we can do this by rewriting history. Let's suppose we wanted to attack this problem by the classical calculus of variations. So now let's assume everything is smooth and our mappings are invertible. So let's, assume that mapping T in script T is a smooth diffeomorphism from omega to omega star. And let's suppose that F and G are both positive in their respective domains. Then what is this mass preserving condition? This is equivalent to the following constraint. Is that g of t times the absolute determinant of dt is f. So it's just the Jacobian determinant of the mapping. So things are smooth, so t is a vector-valued function, and the Jacobian determinant of the mapping at absolute value has to be f divided by g. That's exactly the measure-preserving condition. Right? It's just a condition that there's a change of variables formula. So this is now a first-order PDE in these n functions, t1 up to tn. So that the optimal transportation, the Monge-Kantorovich problem, is a multiple integral Lagrange problem in the calculus of variations. Okay, it's to minimize an integral functional over some constraint, which itself is a differential equation. So the classical Lagrange problem is just concerns vector values, functions of one variable. It was the sort of basis for control theory. And this situation, we have vector functions of many variables. We have a first order PDE constraint, but the functional is only zero order. Okay, but we should be able to write an order Lagrange equation down. So let's this is the problem now. It's to minimize or maximize. I keep the maximize there because if we're looking for critical points, there's not going to be any distinction. This now f times c dot t over t, and say it just takes smooth t and c1 omega to the n c1. These are one-to-one mappings, and they satisfy the constraint star. And there's a boundary condition, which are t omega equals omega star. So that'll be the Monge-Kantorovich problem translated into the classical calculus of variations.
Do we expect t to be 1 to 1?
You would hope, I guess, that you would that at the end you could, yes. I imagine Monge did expect that. He didn't expect his dirt particles to split. But no, in general, in the theory, smoothness is not connected to with being 1 to 1, but asking for smoothness or asking for diffeomorphism is much the same problem.
If it were not 1 to 1, would the equation star even be correct, or would it be a sum of pre integers?
Oh no, the equation would The equation can certainly have a meaning if it's not 1 to 1. Yeah. This heuristic argument I'm going to give though depends on the 1 to 1-ness though. Oh, the equation can be and you can give lots of situations. You can have situations where the two domains are not diffeomorphic or homeomorphic to start with. So your mapping can't be 1 to 1, but it may still be smooth.
But I mean the push forward of the measure, is it even that, is it even, uh, isn't it
Oh, okay. The way I'm writing this now as a diffeomorphism with a with yeah, yeah. If in some sense there is an implicit one-to-oneness because of that being a measure-preserving transformation, and there's a change of variables formula there. And we will pick up results that there's a one-to-oneness AE and things like that. Even for the weak solutions. If I have a smooth solution and I apply this, if I end up with a smooth solution and I apply the mass balance condition, I'm forced into a one-to-one situation as well. Okay, so let's just make a simple heuristic argument. Let's suppose, okay, you have a constrained problem. What you want to do is then solve it by Lagrange multipliers. So let's just suppose that we hit this with a Lagrange multiplier. Lambda, some function of x. Let's see what happens. Let's okay. Things are smooth. Determinant's not zero. It's either going to be positive or negative. So let's just take the case where determinant dt is positive. And let's augment the cost functional. I'm going to see lambda t. Integral f c dot t, and then I add on the lambda times the g times the, so g is composed of t times the determinant of dt. Okay, now just assume that if this Lagrange multiplier method was valid in this situation, and then you would expect critical points of the constrained functional to be those of the augmented functional. They have a pointwise constraint. So in Lagrange multiplier, then is a function, not a constant. So this works, say, in the case of one variable. So let's just see what happens here. Okay, so let's just calculate the order Lagrange equation of this functional. See what we get. So okay, so what's that? We've got to differentiate this with respect to t. So that's going to give me f c sub yi, which is a yi here. And now I'm going to have the di. I have to take the di of, so I have to differentiate respect to the derivatives of t. So this is going to be a lambda times the g. And then differentiate the term, and I get the cofactor. So let me write cofactor dt ij. Okay, and then I've got another piece from this differentiation here. So I've got a minus a lambda, a determinant dt. I'll just write g sub yi. Okay, and there's some cancellation. Just assume everything's smooth. There's some cancellation with the derivatives of g going on here. So this is going to give me di lambda. Then I'll have g composed with t, and I'll get the cofactor matrix of dt again, ij. Okay, that's because the property of that, if I take the divergence of the columns of the cofactor of a Jacobian, that's zero. And now, what's this? This is just F. And now, if I write this in terms of the inverse, right, determinant times inverse, this is the same as F times d sub yi of lambda. So now I'm differentiating the Lagrange multiplier with respect to the y variables.
So when you vary, lambda is constant with respect to the variations of t, isn't it? Why is lambda?
Lambda is a function of x, right? Now I'm going to now I've got the x derivative of lambda here. I've got all this stuff here. I've got the cofactor, times the g. And I can write and I can write that in terms of the inverse times determinant. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be the same as f times the dyi derivative of lambda using my constraint.
That's why.
Yeah. So we've got a very simple equation here. It just simply says that this c sub y is just going to be dy of lambda written as a function of the y. So so if I write v of y equal to lambda of t inverse of y, then this is simply saying that c sub y t inverse y is just dvy. Okay, so then let's do this backwards now. X replaced by y, let's just replace x by y and just do it on omega star back to omega. So I'm using very strongly here the smooth invertibility for mapping. So do it, and then we'd get that c sub x, xt of x would be the gradient of some function u of x. So you can see quite just heuristically that, first of all, that if the Lagrange multiplier method, okay, that's the heuristic step, that's valid, then you've got these relations. There are functions u and v, and these functions are the x and the y derivatives of the cost function on the solution. So these u and v's are called potentials. You can also see something else here, that if this c sub x is 1 to 1 with respect to this, these variables, then this transition from the potential to the mapping is well defined. It's unique. So I can write Tx equals Cx to the minus 1 x dot of du if C sub x is 1 to 1 or invertible. So that the mapping is determined uniquely by the potential. Okay, so we don't know if anything this makes sense yet, but that's essentially displays the relationship between potentials and solutions. I also have another relation here that's quite nice. If I differentiate u of x, and I've got this dual one, v of tx, if I differentiate this minus cx tx, I get 0. So we have this relation, u of x plus v of tx is equal to c of x tx plus a constant, well, and which I could take to be 0. And that relation is somewhat a clue to how to find the u and the v independently of the t. By the way, if I apply this to the Monge cost, we can't get past. Apply this to the Monge cost, what are we getting? We're going to get x minus t of x over x minus t of x equals du. And all we're getting then is the, from the potential, all we're getting is the direction of the displacement. We're not getting anything about its magnitude. So this is not good for, so Monge cost, in the Monge cost case, the mapping is not determined by the potential directly like this. Okay, so let's look for the PDE now. What would the PDE be? Well, assuming everything is smooth, the PDEs, I just applied the constraint, the measure preserving condition, to say the function u. So let me set yxp to be this, just this mapping cx minus 1 x dot p. And let's assume, determined, I want to use the determinant of Cxy, the mixed derivative is not equal to zero on omega cross omega star. And we can check from here that Cxy would just be y to the minus 1 is yp. Absolute of the determinant of d2u minus d squared c dx squared c at t is equal to determinant of this mixed derivative cxy absolute value f over g composed with t. And tx is this mapping y. Or tu, t of, is that mapping y of du. So the measure preserving condition gives me this PDE, but one's not even sure this is the right way to write the PDE at this stage. You might should perhaps write this as the negative and so on. Yes. Oh, okay. So I have to expand the dt, and that's dy of. Just write dtx is dy of x du. And now we expand that. That is the yp d2u. And there'll be a plus a y sub x.
So and yp really means differentiate y.
Y with respect to this variable, the p variable, this second variable, the gradient variables.
Okay.
And then, of course, that's yp to the minus 1 of d2u plus y, that's yp times dtu plus yp to the minus 1 y sub x. And then I take, and then yp to the minus 1, you calculate y sub x is minus 2 derivatives with respect to x of c. So just some calculations there. So I can write it like a Monge-Ampère equation. Except I know nothing about ellipticity or at this stage, I mean, I'm writing it as though I'm going to pretend this is a non-negative matrix here. But that's not come out of this heuristic argument. And that heuristic argument is not distinguishing the max from the min as well. I have to come back to this, because there's two possibilities to be elliptic here for this equation. I mean, things are smooth, so I could either have the positive sign for determinant, I could have a negative sign, and so on. Either one is possible. And there are two possibilities for ellipticity. This is elliptic if d2u is greater than or equal to dx squared c, or d2u is less than or equal to dx squared c. So what I want to do now is now go back to this old Kantorovich argument and use that to get the same equation but distinguish the elliptic solutions. So this is our candidate for the Euler Lagrange equation. We have we're solving for an n vector function. I've now got n plus. I've introduced a new function u. I've got n plus one equations. I've got the equations relating the potentials to the mapping, and I've got this PDE for the potential. So this is the right candidate for this. This is essentially the Euler Lagrange equation. What I haven't refined is just what equation is meant here. Which is it, the elliptic one? Is it something crazy? We know it's going to be elliptic one, of course, from the title of the lectures. But which elliptic one? Well, that's, since I haven't distinguished max or min, you could almost say it has to be the elliptic one, because you've got these two alternates which are preserved by replacing c by minus c. So we have to now somehow distinguish the elliptic equation here. Then that'll be our Euler Lagrange equation. Okay, so the key to that is in some sense this relationship. So let's suppose we have a solution T now. Let T solve the MK problem. And suppose we have these potentials. We have potentials U and V. And I know a couple of things, that if I take the cost functional of any other measure preserving mapping, then that would be less than the cost function respect to t. And now use this formula. It's just, suppose we've adjusted things that this constant is zero. Use that formula. This would be equal to the integral of f of u plus g of v, because it's going to be f of u plus f of v of tx, and then use my measure preserving condition, I get f of u plus integral g of v over omega star. So I would have this relation, that this is less than that, it's equal to that one. And this one would let's see, I want to get this clear. And this one is always going to be less than or equal to, come back again. Let me start this again. Let me jump ahead a bit. I want to define a functional now, J of UV equal to integral F of U over omega plus G times V over omega star. And I want to consider this over the following set, K equals a set of U, pairs U and V in C0 omega bar cross C0 omega star bar, such that U of X plus V of Y is greater or equal to CXY. And I'm going to look at the max problem. Then I can look CT prime, look at this. This is equal to the integral CXT prime X. Any at T prime, it's not a minimizer. And now I can estimate this guy by U X plus V T of X. F there. And this is precisely integral over omega of F U plus integral over omega star of G times V. So that means that this is CT prime will be less than or equal to J UV for all UV in this set K. Okay, so we have a relation between two problems. Now I'll use my relation I have already for the solutions. Now I'll use this relation for my U's and my V's, the equality here. So I have some primes here, maybe prime. But I know that C of T, if I have my optimal guy and I have the associated potentials and I've normalized that constant to be zero, then I know my optimal guy is precisely JUV for the solution. For the solution T and the associated potentials. So you can see that if I have a solution, then the potentials themselves are solving their own minimizing problem. And that's just the Kantorovich dual problem. So we have a way of characterizing those potentials independently of the mapping and the PDE. Oh, sure. I can pass from U to V knowing T.
Okay, but here, I guess in this version of the problem, they seem to be independent of one another. Is the point that they're related this way for one which minimizes this action?
Well, yes. They'll be related. So, okay, so what I've done is simply say, suppose, you know, this Lagrange multiply method is valid, right? Then the optimal mapping is related to potentials in this way.
Right.
Let's suppose we have all these quantities now related this way. Then they in turn will will solve this. They in turn will relate the transportation problem to this other problem, the minimization of J over K. Because I'll have equality for those solutions, so if I take a set of all these U's and V's which are greater than or equal to this, then I'll always have this relation that my cost functionals are less than these J's in the two classes, always less than them, but I have equality in this solution class. So there's a way of characterizing those things without using the T or any differential equation or any smoothness or anything. So, and this is the dual problem. We want to minimize J over K. So now our object is to solve this problem. And then hopefully construct the T from the solution of that problem. So we'll get a solution without using any PDE, but one of the byproducts and will be that we pick up the ellipticity condition on the PDE. You can almost see that from here. If I fix one of these and optimize the other according to this differential inequality, I'm forcing something like that, this ellipticity condition already.
So are you saying that under some condition, like this determinant G is not zero, then these are equivalent problems, otherwise it's not?
No, there's no condition here, actually.
It's always equivalent?
That will come out. Well, yes, I've started by, suppose we got these guys in our hands, this T and this U and the V. Then they are equivalent problems. Now I'm going to solve the second problem, and I want to construct, and from the solution of the second, then I want to show that the first is, I have the first, and they are equivalent. So I've assumed that I've got a solution to the first, and to motivate this, but now I want to come at this one to get the other one. And this, I'll come to how Kantorovich introduced this. He didn't introduce it quite this way. His costs were metrics. And with metrics, you only have one potential, not two. But essentially, this is the approach from Kantorovich, and this is called the dual problem because this is actually the dual of the relaxed problem, which I skipped. I went from the regular problem. We're going to solve this dual problem, get a solution of the regular problem, but in between somewhere is this relaxed problem where you've got the double integrals. Okay, if we take a break now, and I'll come back and just go through the solution of this. So there's really almost no conditions involved here. The only thing we'll need to use basically is this condition to get anywhere from here. Okay, so what I want to do now is just give the existence results for this dual problem. That will give us the potentials, and then from the potentials we construct the mapping, and then that it won't be smooth necessarily. Then we ask the regularity question separately. Okay, so. Let's assume a bit more on C. So, okay, all this is formulated, this dual problem is formulated with almost no conditions on the C, just that continuity and boundedness. Let me just suppose, in fact, what I'll do is, let's suppose C is defined in some set U, and omega cross omega star bar lies in U. U's a set in R, N cross N. And then I'll make my conditions in this bigger set as I go, rather than on the closed domains. So a typical cost function would be defined on Rn cross Rm, but there may be some with singularities, and so you would restrict to a subset. Okay, so now I'm going to sort of upgrade my conditions and see as I go. So I mentioned that Kantorovich's original case was the case where the costs was a metric. So okay, that's not going to be that smooth, so let's just start with C, say Lipschitz in U. And then that's enough to tell me that this dual problem is solvable. Okay, and now the proof here is important because these constructions here come throughout the theory. We want to, okay, how would we solve a problem like that? Well, use the direct method of calculus of variations, construct minimizing sequences. Minimizing sequence by itself may not have any compactness, but we improve them to make them compact. And this is the way we improve them. Let me define for a function U in that class K, or any function, any continuous function, the C star, the C transform. It's what I'll call a C transform. And it's the sup over x in omega Cxy minus U of x. So you can think of y in omega star. So this is the extension to C of the Legendre transform. And keep in mind that my quadratic case is this special case Cxy equals x dot y. So everything we construct or do now will be something well known when we take the case x dot y. Okay, well, one thing that if we look at that U star y, just look at this. This would also be the max on x in omega bar of Cxy minus, just go to the closed domain, minus U of x. So that would be Cxy minus U of x for some x in fixed x in omega bar. And that tells me then that is less than or equal to V of y if UV belongs to that set K. So when I pass to a C transform, I don't decrease the function, which means I'm not, so I don't increase the function, which means I'm not decreasing the integral I want to find. Isn't that the right way around? U star is less than or equal to V of y, so that J UV would be greater or equal, sorry, J of U star. That's how it would go. So I don't increase the functional. So if I make these changes, I don't increase the functional, I clearly stay in my set K. So then we can assume that U and V are the transforms of each other, are the C transform, C star transform. When I go backwards, I call it the C star transform and C transform of each other. So C star x, y always means C of y, x. Turn the variables around. Whenever we exchange the variables, the C becomes a C star. So I could talk about a C star transform of my function V. Put that instead of U. And then I could take the C transform of that guy and put it instead of the V. So I could always assume then that these two functions are in fact the C and C star transforms of each other. Okay, then that builds in some compactness. This then would imply that U and V are both going to be uniformly Lipschitz. They're now Lipschitz. We have a nice bound, for example, U 0, 1. So this is the Lipschitz seminorm, sup of U of X prime minus U X double prime over X prime minus X double prime is that. Call that U 0, 1. Lipschitz seminorm would be less than or equal to, I'll write this out, this is the sup over Y and omega star of C dot Y 0, 1. So the Lipschitz seminorms of the C will control the Lipschitz seminorms of these transforms. In fact, this condition already is an overkill to solve this problem. It's enough just to control this quantity. Okay, so if I start with a minimizing sequence, I can replace it by a uniformly Lipschitz one. Okay, but that's not enough to get compactness. I need uniform bounds. Okay, so there's another normalization we can do. In fact, we have to do. If I add a constant to one function U and subtract the same constant from the other function V, I also preserve the class. So we're free to choose the value at any point of, say, U. So we normalized and take U x0 equals 0 for some x0 in omega. Okay, that gives me a lot of controls. That tells me that then my V of Y I would have my I've got U plus V is greater than or equal to C, so that gives me a bound from below for V. That gives V of Y at any point is going to be greater than or equal to C X zero Y. So I get the y would be bounded from below. The Lipschitz norms of the u's are controlled, and u is controlled at one point, so I've got the u's are uniformly bounded. And we have the u would be bounded by same diameter of omega times the super, again, this super of a y and omega star of this c dot y 0, 1s, and then I know that in that Legendre, in the C transform, that then the max is attained at some point, so this also controls the V from above. So V is also, and the V is also bounded from above. So given then minimizing sequence u sub m, v sub m. We can construct, by the way, this constant replacement, this normalization, you also, that's using strongly the mass balance condition as well, because it's not changing the functional. We can construct a uniformly bounded and uniformly Lipschitz minimizing sequence u sub m, v sub m, and this is obviously going to subconverge to a solution. That's it. So that problem is trivial to solve. Okay, so the next step is to construct from the potentials, I want to construct the optimal mapping. Okay, so I definitely have to upgrade my regularity. To do this, I need some differentiability and then invertibility. Can't avoid the differentiability. And pointwise differentiability as well. So let's just upgrade in the following way to, let's suppose the C is C1U. And I want that C sub X 1 to 1. So this means I want to be able to define this mapping y xp to be c sub x x dot this function, inverse of that function of p. And now just use this property that each of these, that the solutions will be the C and C star transforms of each other. So my solution U of X would be the sup, but I can write that as the max over omega star bar of C X Y minus V of Y. Now my mapping, my optimal mapping is just going to be a selection of this, of the Y that gives the maximum. So okay, that's a multi-value mapping, but almost all, because of this Lipschitz property, that's going to be a single valued mapping almost everywhere. So this gives a mapping T of X, which is Y of X du AE. So you can think of this picture. Here's a picture. There's the graph of U. U is a sup of all these functions. Later on, we're going to call these C affine functions. There'll be at any point of differentiability, there'll be a contact.
Can you explain this to me?
Oh, I'm going to choose it this way. I have to. That's going to give me the mapping. That's going to. T would be in the T would lie in the subset of y, which is so that the y's which maximize this would be set valued, but this u itself is, sorry, u is differentiable almost everywhere. At those points of differentiability, I would have a unique y. Of course, I could have those y's actually could be in the boundary of my omega star. But I would have, at those points of differentiability, I would have such a y. And it's given this way. And this tx would also is going to satisfy, of course, this same condition we had before, that cx t of x is going to be u of x plus v of tx. We're solving this equation. So I'm really solving this. I can solve this equation for a t which is well defined almost everywhere. T of x. By the way, you can't have a thing like the cone. It looks like here you could have all these going to the boundary, like in a cone case. But we're going to prove them. We're going to prove the measure preserving condition, which stops that happening. So that's the formula for my t, which is what we expect from the heuristic development. And now I want to show that t is mass preserving. And the way we'll show that is by using the change of variables formula for test functions. So take an H and C 0 Rn, nice H. Compact support in a minute. And I take a variation in the V's, V epsilon Y, to be V of Y plus epsilon H of Y. If I want to be a little pedantic here, I could keep my support inside omega star and complete, and that way I would H compose with T would be well defined. I wouldn't have that boundary coming in. Okay, then u epsilon. Now with the u epsilon, for the u epsilon, we optimize. We take the C transform. So this will be the sup C star transform y contained in omega cxy minus v epsilon y. So we take the variation in the second component, and then I simply optimize the relation in the with the C star transform in the second. Y and omega star. Yeah, Y and omega star. Now if you look at this carefully, writing it at a point where we have the max taken on in the closed domain and look at that carefully, this is going to be, it's u of x, and we're going to add on epsilon times h composed with t at x, and then what we have left is little o of epsilon. So I'm really taking account of the error coming in between the v epsilon and the v there. That's just a little bit of arithmetic fiddling. Okay, now let's use the minimizing property. Just the standard, this now is a standard calculus of variation. Zero would be the limit as epsilon goes to zero, j u epsilon v epsilon minus j u v divided by epsilon, and this is going to be the limit as epsilon goes to zero, and then here we would get u epsilon minus u over epsilon times f plus this integral over omega plus integral over omega star hg, and this gives me the right result that h composed with t, integral h composed with t over omega is equal to the integral of h over omega star times an f times a g. Okay, next property four is that t is unique, i.e. on the set where f is greater than zero. That we've kind of seen already from the motivation for this problem. That if we had two t's, then the potentials for one would be related to the functional for the other. And then by the uniqueness of the association for t with the potentials, we conclude they're the same. So in some sense, we've seen the inequalities that do this. Okay, so then the upshot is that if we have a kind of Lipschitz condition on the cost, we have this invertibility of the C sub x, then you can find the potential. I want some other properties of T. Let's assume also that the C sub y is invertible. Then you can run this argument through and find a mapping T star. It gives a T star, the same argument. The T star would take omega star to omega. And we'd have these properties that T composed with T star of y equals y AE on the set where g is positive, and T star composed with T x is x AE on the set where f is positive. So we would conclude then that this mapping T is 1-to-1. AE. But we need to build up the symmetric conditions with respect to the y variable as well. Let me just mention this Kantorovich case. This is the famous paper of Kantorovich, only 2 pages long. And there, well, I've used the maximizing problem here. So then there, the minus CXY is a metric. In this case, you get V is equal to minus U. So there's only one potential that comes out of a triangle inequality for metrics. So the original Kantorovich paper, you won't see two potentials. You'll only see one. And then if you look carefully, he's only talking about metrics. So in particular, and then he wrote another paper, 1 page long, where he, in the second paper, he realized that the first paper wasn't about the Monge problem or anything like that. He's looking at the general problem. And the second paper, he realized that this was, in fact, the old problem formulated by Monge. And so then we have the case CXY equals minus CXY equals X minus Y. So in the Kantorovich case, there's no mapping constructed from the invertibility of the C sub X's. There's no mapping constructed that way. So in no way did he solve the original Monge problem. I can mention this, that the original Monge problem has a strange history because was supposedly solved by a probability theorist called Sudukov, 1976, in a huge, huge paper. And some of us, some years ago, found new proofs. There was one with Sujawang and myself, very short, less than 10 pages, different proof. And at the same time, there's one with Caffarelli, McCann, and Feldman, a bit more complicated, like 30 pages. And these were independent, and I guess we all thought that these were new proofs. And then they found that the Sudukov, other people found the Sudukov paper was in fact only true in two dimensions. And so in fact the problem wasn't solved until these papers that we thought were simplifying things, not solving the problem. And there's still a big problem, of course, because these later papers used very strongly a Euclidean structure. Wouldn't have considered arbitrary metrics or norms, and that problem, and that was the generality of Sudukov, so that's still open. It's one of the big open problems. And the origins of these arguments are not kind of clear. When I wrote this out, basically it just seemed to be the same as the quadratic case. Exactly what I was writing there, but there's various papers dealing with these sorts of arguments. Caffarelli, Gungbo, McCann, the ones in the quadratic case, there's a survey by Evans. There's some small papers by a Russian mathematician called Levin where he formulates kind of some of these kind of generalities about whether the minimal sort of conditions on this function C. But the argument here is exactly the same as you're doing x minus y squared or x dot y. And that goes back to two statisticians called Knott and Smith and Jan Brenier. Okay. Let's now fix up the equation. We've got the ellipticity missing. Let's introduce this notion of C convexity. This is not a new notion in these problems. C convexity or C concavity. Let's make a definition that U is C convex. So this is convexity with respect to these cost functions. U is C convex or C concave in this domain omega. This is usually written as saying that U is a sup of U is constructed and something like that. But let's I'll write it as a pointwise condition. The real problem is that when I use that I have to go to the closures of the target sets to get the to get these sort of points y in omega if for all x zero in omega there exists a y zero, and I'll write Rn, but really I mean that the condition in my set U would be that the omega cross y zero belongs to U. Such that U of X is greater than or equal to, or less than or equal to in the case of concavity, U of X 0 plus CX Y 0 minus CX 0 Y 0. So this means there's my graph of U. There's a function of the form CX Y 0 plus constant. We'll call those C affine functions. And then there's a contact, there's a support from below to the graph. So now you can see the importance of that special case x dot y. All this convexity theory, and we'll do more of it next week, is simply replacing in normal convexity x dot y by cxy. And we'll find some remarkable things next week, that the conditions that make the regularity work are precisely the conditions that this is a good replica of a convexity theory. Okay, so let me now upgrade my C a bit more. Let's suppose, I'm not going to go through Lipschitz, let's jump to C2U. So in particular, C is semi-convex, so that C plus nice function is convex, then my U would also be semi-convex. This is so this will tell me that a C convex function will be twice differentiable, or AE. Or C concave functions are twice differentiable AE. And at a point of twice differentiability, we would have the D 2u at x0 would be greater than or equal to, and now just this dx squared at x0. And now the point where the C support is tangent to the graph, we would get here simply this mapping y of x0 du. So I keep assuming this invertibility of this Cx of the C sub x. Okay, so now the potentials.
So
oh, sorry. Yep, thanks. And then we saw from the construction of the potentials that the potentials U and V are C convex and C star convex respectively. So they satisfy this condition, which is precisely the degenerate ellipticity condition for my optimal transportation equation. So if then U is C to omega, if the potential U is C to omega, then it satisfies the, call this the OTE, the optimal transportation equation. And now we can write this properly, determinant of D2U minus. And we have a function here, and I'll just write this as A dot du, and that'll be some function B dot du, and these two functions will be the following. A dot du will be two x derivatives of the C at y dot du, and this B will be the mixed xy derivative f divided by g composed with y dot du. And of course, inside here is also x and y. So this is going back to the derivation of the equation, but now we have the ellipticity condition coming from the C convexity, so we can get rid of the absolute value sign and simply write the equation like this. And this condition is the condition for degenerate ellipticity. Of course, if f and g are positive, of course you have an elliptic solution. If g positive implies a solution is elliptic. Okay, we can work this backwards as well. There's also a boundary condition involved. That's this. I'll write it as I'll have to also point out why it's actually a boundary condition, but at the moment it doesn't look like a boundary condition, that that this mapping y dot du sends omega to omega star. So if I have a C2 solution of the optimal transportation problem, and the image of this of T is omega star, then it satisfies this PDE and boundary condition. I go backwards. If I have a solution of this boundary value problem, which is smooth, can I say that that solves the optimal transportation problem? Well, not necessarily. I would need, see, this condition here is kind of the localized C convexity. So if we go backwards, so if we have a solution, if we have, let's say, a smooth, I really mean globally smooth now, solution of the PDE plus the boundary condition, it solves the MK problem. That means that from the potential I construct the optimal mapping. And if and only if, of course, that it is C convex. Right, because the solution of the optimal transportation problem has to come from a C convex potential. Oh, boundary condition. I'm saying boundary condition here, but it doesn't look like a boundary condition, but in fact it is a boundary condition when it's nice. Maybe I have 1-to-1 here, maybe. Maybe be careful. That would come, if I impose the mass balance condition, that would come, but let's just leave the 1-to-1 there. So there's one question here straight away. When is a function which is elliptic for the equation C convex? So we call this sort of locally C convex. We could call a condition like this locally a local C convex. So you can ask one question straight away. When is a locally C convex function C convex, globally C convex? That would mean that if I can solve the elliptic boundary value problem, I would solve the optimal transportation problem if I can answer this question. Turns out this is related to lots of questions, the whole regularity theory is as well. We'll answer that question next time. And also provide the conditions that these potentials that we've constructed are in fact smooth solutions of the elliptic equation. And we know that if you have a locally convex function, you need a convex domain. So the answer here would be a condition on the cost function and a condition on the domain. And all these conditions will be essentially the same for lots of the questions that come up about regularity and generalized convexity theory. So that's just introductory. Then next week I'll mostly discuss the paper with Shinan here and Suja Wang, where we introduce the domain conditions, we introduce the conditions on the cost functions, and then there's and prove that under these conditions, then we have these smooth diffeomorphism solutions. But it turned out later that these conditions for the PDE were also the conditions to have a whole generalized convexity theory when you replaced x dot y by c of x y. Now I won't get onto the geometric aspects of this. Hyung Kim knows quite a bit about that, so he probably spoke something already about the geometric side. When you come to manifolds, there's a fundamental cost function. It's just geodesic distance squared, and these conditions will be for this cost function fourth order conditions on the metric, not at all understood. Understood for spheres and some other manifolds, but not understood in general. So that's the big area that's opened up in geometry at the moment. Vivani will talk a bit about that next year too. I'll just go into a Euclidean space regularity result next week.